Hey, everybody. Thank you so much for listening to the podcast in the first segment. Oh, man, we talk about so much. We are in hot, hot, hot Orlando. It is so muggy. And why is it hot? Because the All-Star Game is happening. So many cool things. Everybody thinks Christian is Nani. We also talk about Jill Ellis. We talk about Carlos Cordeiro. We talk about a lot.
All the drama. And in the second segment, we are talking to John Strong, who's going to be calling the game. He's calling the All-Star Game with Stu Holden and Katie with him. So we talk All-Star Game. We talk Atleti. We talk, some Timbers chat. You know how it is.
And we solve the puzzle that is, why is Christian talking like this?
Yeah, it's a strange day today.
Well,
so
that and more on this episode of the Cooligans.
Hey, this is Alexi Lawless. There is nobody in U.S. soccer that is more important than the Cooligans.
Yeah, baby!
Expect that kind of energy after the after the kind of days that we've had.
So days spelled D-A-Z-E.
Oh, sure, oh, sure. Yeah. Okay. I spell it B-A-Y-Z, but okay. That's just me, you know.
Yeah. You help boys to men come up with a spelling for their name as well?
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the show. Just a quick... we have to get in front of it because it's already a big story, but my voice is a little weird.
It's a little rough.
Okay. We're currently in Orlando.
That's right.
We are recording
the humidity capital of the United States of America.
Okay. Yeah. That's it. It's the humidity is their state flag.
Uh-huh. It's their GDP. They're like, what, you dry out there? You need this joint? Lotion. There's no reason to buy lotion in this city.
Don't need it.
No,
all right. My voice is pretty much shot.
Your voice is matching the look of your face. Okay. You have the age, the look of a very young boy, and now you have the voice of one.
All right.
You hear puberty, folks.
Puberty's it's coming right now on this show.
Oh, yeah.
You're hearing me become a man. Okay. So my voice has been pretty shot from talking to a bunch of people, going out, talking to a bunch of hanging out with journalists at loud bars, you know, that, I don't know if you understand the lifestyle that we sort of lead. If you are a person who wants to work in soccer, a big part of the job is speaking loudly to people at bars.
Yeah. You need to be able to talk over Creed if you want to succeed in this business.
Exactly. Okay.
Also, you need to have a liver that will probably not cirrhose.
So apologies ahead of time, but it is what it is. I hope that my trash ass voice doesn't affect the quality of the jokes.
That's right, because we're going to continue to be trash ass jokes.
So welcome to the show, everybody. My name is Christian Polanco.
Yes, it is. And my name is Alexis Guerreros.
And we are your favorite stand up comedians that host the funniest soccer podcast that you have ever listened to.
And I kind of want to hear you say it in this voice. What else are we?
We're also the goliest soccer podcast that you've ever listened to.
That's right. You heard Fightful.
Okay, we are in Disneyland.
Yeah, that's right. Only the gulliest voice. You know, if someone says something wild gully in that voice, you should be scared.
Exactly. Okay.
There's a great rapper from Toronto, Canada, named Pressa, and he has a very childlike voice, but it sounds demonic.
Oh, wow. Okay. I didn't think this voice could intimidate a soul.
Yeah.
Apparently, I was wrong.
We found all you had to do was get punched in the throat by your girlfriend who was here with us in Orlando for a couple of days.
Yeah. It was the first time my girlfriend got to experience one of these soccer trips that we take.
Yeah, soccer trips. And she, probably the last. I think, she was like, what? This is what you guys do? It's all work and no play. I told you.
You know, she thinks we're out gallivanting with all these soccer tots.
Right? Ain't no soccer tots.
Ain't no soccer tots.
No.
Babe.
Yeah. Charles Bone. Not much of a soccer tot.
Okay.
You know?
It's EMLS virgins. Yeah. We're all virgins.
Yeah. We said in a correct voice for that statement. Kevin Egan of Atlanta United and formerly of being one sports, not much of a soccer thought.
Exactly. So even though he does be wearing some real salacious clothing.
Oh, that's right. That bomber jacket. Be looking mad tight, Kevin Egan.
If you haven't been to MLS All-Star, it is very much an opportunity for everyone to kind of gather, reconnect. The people different you know, employees from all around the league get to like basically see each other.
That's
at once, and it's a good, not only just like networking opportunity, but there's like a bunch of fun events planned around it. There's like community.
Yeah, even if you don't work in soccer or have a podcast, shit like that, if you're just a fan, there's a lot of great stuff for you to go see. You know? The EMLS competition we were a part of, I can't believe that was free. That was like getting to see like a full television show competition production kind of thing.
Exactly. And it was,
and we were a part of it, so you know it was luxurious.
Exactly. Finally, the EMLS matches the level of luxury that the Cooligans bring.
We requested said luxury levels, and they have been met. And also, shouts to EMLS. We're just one letter away from actually working with EMLS on something. We're trying to make that MLS. We're trying to get Gam and Tam money, son. And by the way, we never work for them fully, son. We always gonna be independent. We gotta keep it gully.
Okay, yeah. Why do you want to list out our resume?
Yeah, sorry. We don't keep it gully though.
So
our resume is written on cardboard with a Sharpie, my guy.
And it says, "Please give us money." People think we're homeless.
Oh, is that why y'all got that impression? Because of this empty cup I'm sitting here? This is for you to put that big old check in it.
Yo, don't disrespect me like that, dog.
I know.
So we got to, the EMLS challenge was dope. We got to hang out with Diego Forlan playing, who was also playing.
This time I did not scare him. He also refused to speak to me, so I feel like he remembered me.
I said hello to him, and I was speaking to him in Spanish. I think he was like, "What? Well, you speak Spanish?" Like,
oh,
okay.
Yeah, because he's from Uruguay, where they're like, "Didn't we get rid of the black people? Who taught you how to speak Spanish?"
He was like a little taken aback. I don't know, but he was awesome, man.
And Landon Donovan. Although, you know, the gif of him doing the dab has gone a bit viral now.
Yeah.
His trash-ass dab. Yeah. His dab is worse than your voice.
Yeah, and my voice is pretty bad.
Yeah, I made fun of him. I said, "Dude, you're not doing the dab. You're doing the dad."
Yeah.
And he kind of laughed at it, but it was also like, ooh, that was cold.
Yeah, well, Landon Donovan is young enough that he should know how to properly do a dab. That's my opinion.
I said to him, I was like, yeah, I mean, he was playing when it was hot. Right?
Yeah.
He was, I think, playing in Mexico when it was hot, at León.
Yeah.
I said to him, I was like, "Yo, dog, like, come on. I got to show you a couple Migos videos." And he looked at me like, "Migos?"
Yo, I didn't realize Landon Donovan was that out of touch, even though he has a pretty good first touch.
Yeah, great first touch.
Yeah, but quite out of touch.
Bit of a finisher. It's the stuff in between that we're worried about.
But that was a dope experience and a cool thing to really be a part of. So
yeah, dude, shouts to EMLS for making us a part of that. And check out their competitions, man. It's a real blast.
Yeah, well, watch the broadcast of it. It's on Periscope right now. So if you go onto EMLS... I think just the MLS Periscope, you can watch the broadcast, and you know, you scrub through, get to our match is the third one.
When Christian plays, they let me call the game along with Kevin Egan and Stephen Keel.
Yeah, so,
and that may be the last time I have ever given a chance to call the game.
So yes, three equally respected broadcasters sharing the stage.
At one point, Kevin Egan goes, "That's the voice of Alexis Guerreros." Just making it clear that wasn't me, folks.
So it was a really cool experience, and we've been having a great time out here in
Orlando.
It's been
a blast.
And we do have to give a shout out to Ivan
and King, Ray.
And Ray Kingzo, who surprised us, you know, at our hotel, gave us an incredible gift.
Normally, surprising us at the hotel is not a good thing. Sure. Are you my dad? Well, what are you doing here?
Cop!
You think I can't run? I know where the exits are already.
So, they gave you would remember them as the Platano Phone guys.
That's right.
That we did like an Instagram live with. You can see the video on our YouTube channel. And they were the guys, they're two Orlando City fans that were, the camera panned to them and they were holding two plantains.
With a string, like a phone cord between them.
Yeah, connected to each other. And they both had antennas coming out of them. And that was the Platano phone. Or they call it the iPlatano.
The iPlatano. Right. iPlatano.
So... we got to meet them in person in Orlando. I actually saw them at the Prince Royce concert because, of course,
Yeah, right. Of course. Where else would you meet said Dominican and Haitian besides at the meeting that you guys had, Prince Royce held for everybody?
Exactly. We didn't even have to discuss. I didn't have to send them a calendar request.
No. No, it was foretold in the stars.
So, saw them there. Said hello. It was really, really cool. They were shocked to see me, and that was awesome. But they came to the hotel, gave us an incredible gift that we've already unboxed on video. But so you can watch that.
You
can watch that.
It's an absolute honor what they did for us
on Instagram. But they gave us kits.
Yeah, of our respective countries,
a Dominican Republic kit.
And a Cuban kid.
Custom made.
That's right.
With like a lot of detail.
The coat of arms, the saying. I can't wait till you guys see it. We should do like an infographic on it.
I was almost in tears, man. It was so cool.
Legitimately, like I never expected 4 years ago when we put on turn the microphone and recorder on, that at some point someone would be giving us customized kits with our, heritage attached to it.
Yeah, man. It's a Dominican dude and a Haitian dude who both love soccer, both love their country's soccer. Like in Dominican Republic, the sport is kind of still growing.
Yeah.
Haiti, they had a great run in the Gold Cup.
They've leveled up.
So you love to see it, Alexis.
I love to see it.
It was awesome. And for us to be welcome and sort of, they appreciate what we do. We appreciate what they do. And that's the kind of like culture and things we need to see in American soccer.
I think we said it in the video, but, part of what we want to do on this podcast is highlight this sort of new culture of soccer. You know what I mean? We don't have to be, all stodgy like some of the older leagues that exist in Europe. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like we could create our own thing, you know?
Nobody even watches those old leagues in Europe.
No, dude, they're not popular at all. I mean, they're spending too much money for the lack of ratings that they're getting.
So let's
shouts to those guys.
Thank you guys again, man. It means the world. So let's, I want to read a quick review because we are, we're crushing it in the reviews. We're at 534 plus our Canadian reviews. So those are still up there.
Yo, shouts to all the Canadians. I just made a presser reference. Okay. So shouts to all the Canadians out there.
Okay.
Doing the damn thing.
So I want to read one. This is comes from Darling Dearest, who we may know quite well. This is Kale Parker.
Well, this can't be a new review. You must be reading a very old review because Kale is a day one.
Yes. So this is apparently it'll explain itself in the review. So I know Kale appreciates me reading this review in this voice because I'm sure it sounds exactly like her. So it says, the subject says, yeah, this podcast is gully, but it's also the best.
Okay. Aww.
And 5 stars, of course. So Kale goes on to say, as the one-time princess of the Cooligans podcast, I realize I have most definitely been usurped by Ali Krieger, which is not true.
Yeah. Thank you.
No, I would not agree with that statement. And then she continues. She says, y'all know I love these guys. As someone who listens to a lot of soccer content, no, none wearing sports coats, okay? This podcast is definitely the funniest and obviously the gulliest, but it's also just the best. Alexis and Christian interview like no other. You won't find another team that brings out personalities like this one. Y'all mentioned that you're missing reviews from other countries, but it should also be pointed out that I've left a handful of reviews in the past, which were never posted. Now, I'm not here to yell conspiracy, but I hope when they storm Area 51, they find all those missing reviews, because I'm sure I'm not the only one. This goes all the way to the top. Go right around over.
Shouts to Kale, man, who's now living in Seattle, just living her best life.
Huge Sounders fan. Was living in Chicago when we met her.
That's right.
Came out to us to the All-Star Game.
That's right.
Awesome. Not only a fan, dear friend, and we're happy. Thank you for this review.
Yeah, Kale. I would say that she's one of the first people who was like a fan of the show that we actually like, maybe not from the New York area, that we got to like meet.
Sure.
And like become like close friends with. Like, I feel like I could have any conversation in the world with Kale. You know, she probably doesn't want that because she's heard this podcast, but I feel like I could,
But I think she was the first person. She was the first woman listening where we used to make jokes. We're like, the women even listen to us, idiots. Yeah. It's like first year doing this podcast. We're like, there's no way girls could like,
apologize. We're like, I'm sorry if there are any women listening.
We just said something very stupid.
We say this because we don't know what we're talking about.
And she was one of the first. I was like, yeah, I'm listening. And you know,
she's like, there's some of us.
Well, we hear more and more about the growth of the female fan base for Major League Soccer. And I think that was a thing when we started. We just were not aware. Especially, you know, we only knew Rebels and NYCFC. Like, yeah,
we knew, but we weren't like getting deep. Now that we're like deep in MLS, we're finding out that there's all these like just this great culture. It feels like our fan base is 50-50, which is such an honor.
It's no, the numbers don't say that, Alexis.
You know, but I said it feels.
It feels, okay.
Yeah, it feels like it is. Because when we go to events, it feels like there's a lot of women that represent. You know what I mean? I want to read this one. This is from Luetigal, whatever. Happy to find it. All right. 5 stars. Initially, I discovered the Cooligans while listening to a totally different show that is also about soccer. Okay, I wonder if it's totally about soccer. At first, I wasn't sure if it was for me. It was like arriving at a party and immediately thinking, am I cool enough to be here? Then one day, they did a bit about a suburban mom in a minivan frantically Googling the names of the rappers they were discussing while I was simultaneously Googling the names of those same rappers while sitting in my Subaru in the parking lot of a Qdoba. It hit me. They know I'm here and they are perfectly okay with it. Even if some of us may be more gully adjacent. Great show, guys. Shouts to all the gully adjacents.
Yeah, you count too.
Yeah, yo, we need y'all. We need people on the fringes going, yo, hurry up. The cops are coming. Every gully needs a lookout. And that's y'all.
Exactly.
In your Subarus, in your Qdobas.
So thank you for that. Luetigal.
Luetigal.
Luetigal. We appreciate you. So help us get to 600 reviews. Why not? We're having a good time out here.
I mean, look, 600 means the world to us. 500 meant the world to us. 600 will mean the world to us. Yo, get us to 1,000.
Why not?
Yo, Kale, keep leaving these ghost reviews until we hit 1,000.
Okay. We've sent the army out to do the job.
You know what's funny? We talk about reviews so much that there's people that have been like, yo, I love the show. I haven't left a review yet, but I'm gonna. And I'm always like, yo, you better do that. You ain't even allowed to talk to me until you do. It's so dope. But people like somebody honked a horn at us and was like, cool again. Oh, since we were walking around Orlando.
We were just getting catcalled.
What you wearing?
Yeah, nice tits. Yeah. Wait, who are you talking to?
Bring that sweet voice of yours over here.
I'm like, is it me? I guess it's me.
Yeah. If you're talking about tits, it's me. You know that.
So, all right, let's. We are here at MLS All-Star, but today, huge news broke regarding the U.S. women's national team.
That's right. I ate a salad. Well, no, the other huge news.
Yes. the salad that shook the world.
By the way, fans are disappointed in me.
They want you to die sooner? Well, I mean, understand.
I feel like I've made a strong point of saying I would never eat a salad. And I will tell you, Kobe Jones guilted me into it.
Okay.
He is very good.
Typical Kobe Jones.
Right? Just making it all about himself.
Yes, you had breakfast or lunch?
I had lunch with Kobe Jones and Kevin Egan.
Look at that.
I mean, this is why you come to All-Star, right? It's to have lunch with me.
Exactly.
And I had the burger dialed up, and I thought, you know what? The burger might make me look a little fat. Everyone else here is eating a salad. Why don't I go with the filet mignon sliders?
Yeah, the burger might make you look fat. Not your clothing, your body.
Not the body.
Your actual body fat.
Well, I'm not sitting anywhere near the two of them because they both look great, okay? And shouts to Kevin Egan, who just had a 7-month-old at home. Okay. So shouts to him. I forgot he had a baby. We didn't congratulate him. But long story short, I ordered last. As I got there last, they had already ordered. And Kobe's like, what are you going to order? And I'm like, oh, you guys ordered salads. I might not. And he goes, yeah, the salad here is actually very good and filling. And I was like, here's what I'll do. I'll ask the waiter, how big is the salad? And he'll say, it's not that big. And then I'll just go, give me the sliders. Happy medium between a salad and a burger is the sliders, I think.
Sure.
Right?
Yep. Makes total sense.
Yeah. That hits a 50 from the 0 to 100, right? And I thought maybe I'll get a side salad, you know?
Okay.
So I said to the guy, and I was like, hey, how big is the Caesar salad? And he goes, oh, it's actually really big and filling. And I was like, you son of a bitch. You threw me under a bus, buddy. Wow.
But
and
know,
I
was like, realistically, men usually lie about the size of their salads.
You call this 7-inch salad? This is depressing. I was like, fine. And then I was going to get the steak. And the guy goes, you know, the salmon's really good. And I was like, all right, well, then I guess I'll get the salmon.
Okay.
So there I am. Salmon Caesar salad, goddammit.
I'm sure it was
living a lie.
I'm sure it was delicious.
Living a lie. It was filling.
Well, no, I didn't want to talk about that.
Okay, but we did. You want to talk about Jill Ellis.
I want to talk about Jill Ellis because she announces that she is stepping down as the head coach of the U.S. Women's National Team.
Not retiring, just stepping down.
Done. She's done with it.
Done with it. Did it. Won the World Cup. What's next?
Yeah, twice.
Yeah, until the Monstars show up. I got nothing else to win.
Okay, find me some real competition.
Yeah, this is embarrassing. You call yourself a nation.
No, pretty crazy. I think pretty unexpected.
I mean, very unexpected.
Especially with this kind of success. And I mean, she could have had a long run of with a lot of support.
Here's what I think happened is first of all, she gets basically like a 4-year vacation, right? Until the next World Cup. I mean, there's a lot of like, you know, friendlies and stuff, but she could have mostly chilled.
Olympics are coming up as well.
Olympics are coming up as well. That's true. But here's what I think. I think she realizes, and Meg Linehan mentioned this on our show.
Of The Athletic.
Of The Athletic. Wonderful reporter. And she was there the entire time in France. But she mentioned this, and I think this is where this comes from, that Jill Ellis, or the women's national team, this is their last hurrah, having an overwhelming advantage.
Okay.
And that the next time, you know, these players are starting to develop a lot more in other countries. A lot of other countries are now taking women's soccer a lot more seriously. A lot of the female players are starting to become a lot more, higher quality, higher level of competition. So if that's the case, then the next cycle might not be as easy. And then that ruins the legacy of a Jill Ellis. So you walk away now. The old Seinfeld, you hit a good bit, good night, you walk away.
Sure.
That's what she did. She took her second World Cup win when everyone told her she was going to lose to France in this joint. And she comes out.
Everybody didn't tell her that.
Well, you know, there was a lot of talk.
A lot of people said that.
Yeah. We could say everybody. It's a podcast. No one takes it seriously. People were saying she might lose and it wasn't guaranteed, blah, 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 blah. You know what? Wave off. I won. Goodbye, everybody. And now she could go take a big money job at Lyon or Arsenal. Ladies was a big, somebody mentioned that. Okay. There's a bunch of jobs that she could take. You know what I mean?
But there's no job bigger than the U.S. Women's National Team head coach.
But she did what she could with it. So sure. Now go get paid off of that.
Okay. No.
This is your big money time. And if that fails, you could be like, well, they had a terrible, you know, infrastructure. I'm still Jill Ellis, who won the World Cup twice. Where else can I go?
But a lot of people do feel that Jill Ellis only won because of the incredible roster that the U.S. had.
Of course, but who cares? She has the cachet. She got the ring.
I'm not taking it away from her.
If somebody says something like, well, didn't you just win because of the talent? Hit him with the ring.
I mean, either she left out of like, you know, personal reasons. Maybe she just needed a break, wanted some time off. Or she felt like... I can't do this for another cycle, or I can't deal with the, I can't work with U.S. soccer.
I can't work under this pressure anymore.
There is a lawsuit, you know, maybe it, you know, I don't know if she's given, any clear, reasons per se.
I didn't read anything that gave unnecessarily next steps of her career.
Exactly. Oh, why she quit to begin with.
No.
Or why she stepped down to begin with. So, yeah, sort of a bit. I didn't expect it. I thought she would be around at least for the next Olympics or another World Cup. But we do see national team managers across men's soccer and women's. Like, it's two cycles is pretty common. That's like a good run, unless you're.
That is a great run, but it's also the difference between the amount of stress you feel on an average day, and then all of a sudden gearing up for the World Cup, that's got to take its toll on you.
Sure.
And, you know, now that the stress level has come down, she celebrated, right? It's the end of the celebration a bit right now. She thinks to herself, I really don't want to put myself through that anymore.
Okay. Yeah. I mean, put herself through what?
Champagne.
Too much champagne.
Too much champagne. You know? Oh, God. All of the Good Morning Americas. To be honest, she didn't do much of the media stuff.
No, she didn't.
But you really didn't see her.
She's never really been the focal point of the success of the team.
Do you have any doubt in your mind that if I brought any team to the World Cup twice in one, that I would find a way to make it completely about myself?
No, never. You too much humility. You never do it.
Yeah. Did you say too much humidity? I agree. I'm too moist.
So to piggyback off of that, I sound like Miss Piggy when I said that.
To Miss Piggyback off of that.
To Miss Piggyback off of that. Well, let's talk about the head of U.S. soccer, Carlos Cordeiro.
Who
wanted to take a little bit of shine off of Jill Ellis's day. You know, he posted a thing on a four-letter statement. A four-page letter, just like Aaliyah.
Yeah.
So
Wow. Very nice.
I'm writing you a four-page letter. So it's very emotional.
And I seal it with a kiss. Actually, he sealed it with a diss.
So he posted this letter on Twitter, which is where you do your professional communication nowadays.
Also, it was clearly this was stored in a folder on his desktop under the word shade.
So if you haven't read the letter, it's
We haven't either.
I did. Don't say we.
Okay.
I did read the whole thing. It is follow Carlos Cordeiro. I mean, or don't follow Carlos Cordeiro.
Just Google it.
It is on Twitter. It's CAC Soccer is Carlos Cordeiro's Twitter handle. And it's basically a fact sheet.
Which is fair because he's kind of a cack. You know what I mean?
it's unnecessary. Which is like, that's the annoying part, but it's also wildly childish.
So does that now make perfect sense?
No sense whatsoever. So he lists a fact sheet about why, basically saying like,
he made a bunch of claims and then he put in a fact sheet.
Yes, he basically
supporting his claims.
To paraphrase the entire thing, he's basically like, yo, we're good guys.
We're not that bad.
We're not doing anything bad to these ladies. We're good.
The problem is these ladies don't understand math. And it just turns out I do. So let me explain to you how the women made more than the men in 2018.
Okay, so there are...
Which is, by the way, anyone you mention that to that knows anything about soccer would immediately be like, well, yeah, one group made it to the World Cup and the other one didn't.
Exactly. You could understand why they would make more money total.
Yes.
But they had to also work more than the men. So it's not equal pay, nor is it equitable pay.
No. And by the way, they also threw in the NWSL salaries of the women on the national team.
Yes.
Which is trash.
So this is all Carlos Cordeiro, right? And he is basically making, and there's a lot of claims here. We can't really break them all down, but he's essentially saying like they get paid more, and I don't want to just casually just say they get paid more, but he says collectively in this particular span of years that I don't have in front of me, but that he highlighted, he was like they were paid more in these particular set of years and collectively. So that is that's not saying it's not a one to one. Like Michael Bradley makes as much as Ali Long, right?
No.
And if they both played a game, a friendly or whatever,
they both be able to buy as much groceries as the other. No, that's not the case.
That's not what he's saying. But he basically used every accounting move.
Yeah. Possible. This is a mafia accountant version of being like, well, I mean, if you look at it this way, my client paid almost too many taxes.
See, and that's the problem. You're not looking at it the way I'm looking at it.
I mean, I feel like you're looking at it in a very different way. And if you do that, we're never going to see eye to eye.
So, it's, when I first read it, I read it without seeing any of the opinions about it or any of the criticism. So I'm reading it. And as a person who hasn't seen a counterpoint and is just like waiting to sort of shape my own opinion about it.
Right.
I'm like, this doesn't look right.
Yeah, this seems funny.
It's like they wouldn't sue if they're making more money.
Right.
Right. It's like this doesn't sort of feel right. And then, I mean, he's being dragged.
Dragged is not the word. I mean, he is being lambasted.
Yeah. So,
I mean, he was on. We were in the lobby waiting for our friend to show up, and Dan Levitard shows on, and Dan Levitard is doing a full segment about this.
Yeah.
And they have women's soccer experts on the show breaking down how this is trash. The men's side of U.S. soccer has come out and said, "Whoa, They didn't ask us because he claims to have spoken to them and getting facts from them. And they're like, whoa, 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 whoa. We didn't give him any facts. He never spoke to us about it.
Yeah.
And they're like, and we don't agree with this math at all. But here's the genius of it. Okay.
Okay.
And I know this is you and I, we talk about this sometimes. If it comes to something, what's the word with the D that Glenn Crook said? I like, when something is like being hidden from you or whatever.
Deception?
Deception, right? When it comes to deception, you come to me. Not remembering the word, but just doing the thing.
Not, yes.
Right? We get it. Words are my thing, right? Here's where this is great. He's muddying the waters. He's causing confusion. Where I think it's backfiring is everyone else is finding facts.
Sure.
And now he's like, God damn. But what he was trying to do is pull an old politics tactics, which is just send out as much misinformation as possible and confuse. And what will happen is the real information will only get to a certain select few. Where he's confusing this and where he made a misstep is that the amount of people paying attention to this part of women's soccer is not as grand as the amount of people that are now being told this guy lied, because it's now hitting every news channel.
Yeah.
And it's clearly a slow news week. So he's all of a sudden, boom, 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 boom. Everyone is talking about this, and more people are hearing about this than ever read his letter or heard about his point. So he's not necessarily muddying the water. The water's being filtered out faster than he can muddy it. Here's the other issue. He does this right when Jill Ellis says she's leaving. So everyone's paying attention to the left, a little bit misdirection. You release this wild talk with the right, thinking, not many people are going to notice it, and it's going to hit even harder after everyone finishes talking about Jill Ellis, which is trash. And U.S. soccer keeps doing this.
Yeah.
U.S. soccer keeps doing this. They did, what did they do during the Women's World Cup? They announced something, right? I forgot what it was. Like they just keep doing this. They just keep announcing things.
I mean, they had other finals the same day as the World Cup final.
But
not that.
No, they'll like announce things. They'll put out like news bits that they hope get sort of, you know, caught in the background and not give as much shine. These are all sort of leftovers from a previous regime that I had this silent hope that would go away. You know, the increased transparency, the lack of political games, the lack of treating their players like assets and not people, all these things that I had hoped would go away, and I clearly have not.
Yeah, and overall, you gotta... When I read this, my first kind of thought is, why is Carlos Cordeiro posting this? What is exactly the advantage? And you sort of made the point about muddying the waters, but I did think, like, what advantage does he gain? And he's trying to get some, you know, sway the popular opinion, right? The women cheering equal pay when he was on stage at the parade in New York.
Yeah.
Right? They're Megan Rapinoe will, you know, be more famous than Carlos Cordeiro could even dream.
Right.
He cannot compete. And it seems like he's sort of trying to influence the decision a little bit, but I also don't understand what he's fighting exactly, right? I don't believe that the women's national team is trying to take advantage of U.S. soccer and get more money than they deserve, right? So what exactly does he have to gain? And I'm not saying he has to give them everything that they want, because clearly there's a finite amount of money and he can't just give them absolutely everything. But when it comes to paying both of these teams equally, and realistically, for now, until the popularity of women's soccer is bigger, realistically, the women will always probably have to succeed more than the men. Not always, but for the next, you know, foreseeable future, they'll have to be more successful than the men to probably make as much money, right?
But it's also stopping us, to your point, I don't think he gains anything. Part of me thinks this is such a bad misstep that maybe he's fighting people on the inside, and I don't want to make him seem like a good guy. So this is just a theory that is one of the 50 theories that I have. Maybe he's fighting people on the inside that don't want to give them the money, because to me, it's more of a budgeting issue. Remember the last coaches conference we went to, everybody was talking about the 100 plus million million that they have in the bank. And everybody wants to spend it a million different ways. And everyone's like trying to fear how that's going to sort of run away and then it's going to go away. Part of me thinks he wants to pay them, maybe. And since no one else is willing to do it, he sends this out as sort of like just release the garbage and everyone see how garbage it is. And oh, well, my arms are being twisted. I have to give them the money. Maybe that's a possibility. Because there's nothing else that makes sense for releasing this. Yeah. It's clearly falsified on many levels, so much that the men's side of U.S. soccer had to come out against this. And it's making Carlos look bad. This, to me, seems like it should be, if not could be, the end of his presidency. This leaves a bad stain. You can't trust a man who has released a letter with nothing but, you know, and it's not false numbers. It's numbers manufactured to make him look better and to make the other side look wrong. This doesn't make any sense. And this doesn't, now we can't talk about how Sky Blue has sold so many tickets for their game against Reign FC that they're asking their fans if it's okay to move it to Rebel Arena, which is huge.
Yeah.
And we've been talking about how women's soccer has had these opportunities and they've never been able to capitalize on it. Now it seems like the NWSL is actually able to capitalize on it. And what is it? Hashtag won't stop watching or can't stop watching. They have like their own hashtag.
What did he say?
Yeah. He said, can't stop, won't stop.
Watching.
Yeah. Watching. But like, now we're seeing the signs of these successes. And yet again, they're getting U.S. soccer, instead of saying, this is making us money, let's help, they're stepping on their own feet and they're stepping on the feet on the feet of others. This is ridiculous.
Yeah, it's a weird strategy. I don't get it.
To call it a strategy is giving it a compliment. Well, what is happening?
It seems like the... Look, from as a fan, it's like, yo, these women are putting U.S. soccer on the map. You take advantage of that. Pay them what they're worth. You know, use their popularity. They're on every TV show. Josie Altidore on Jimmy Kimmel? Is, you know,
is he going sneaker shopping with Joe LaPuma?
Exactly. Like this is the disconnect where we constantly talk about the culture.
Right. Ain't nobody asking Michael Bradley to eat hot wings.
Oh, I would love to see his red bald head.
You know he won't have any emotion.
just a machine eating those things, pounding them down.
Yeah. He's, dude, are you eating the bones?
So, if I was running U.S. soccer, I'd be like, yo, the man ain't doing much. Let me take advantage. Let's grow their own personal brands. Let's help use that to propel U.S. soccer, get more people into the sport. Take advantage of it.
The truth is both sides could learn from each other.
Yeah.
And this, they're causing a split, and the split isn't amongst the players, but they're causing a split within U.S. soccer for no good reason.
Yeah. It's odd. So, we'll stay on top of it. You know, I know you come to us, to get the details on all these, all these
legal
stores.
Proceedings. you come to Cooligans for that.
So, but it was a pretty fascinating thing. If you weren't like, if you're not as, ingrained in, soccer Twitter, cause it was pretty wild.
And shouts to Jill Ellis, you know, you didn't get much of a chance to get a congratulations cause all this crap came out, but, congrats to you. Good luck with whatever as you're doing. The lasting impression of you won't be, Hope Solo's nasty comments. It'll be you hoisting a second World Cup in a row.
Exactly. You can't argue with the trophies that she's won. So we are at in Orlando at the All-Star Game, at the All-Star Week, right? And there's still a bunch of stuff going on. We're going to the Skills Challenge.
So that's going to happen soon.
We're recording this on Tuesday, the day of the Skills Challenge. So right after we're done recording this, we're going to head over there. So we'll let you know what it was like, and I would have watched it on TV, but we'll let you know how we experienced it on our next episode.
On the front lines.
Also, make sure to listen to the part two episode of the crossover Total Soccer Show episode that we also did. Those may have come out on the same day. I'm not sure when.
Yeah, I'm not sure what's happening. But yeah, it'll be out. You'll have access to it.
Exactly. So tune in. My voice is less worse than this.
Yeah. Shouts to all the Gully Squad members who got to ask questions on that episode. That was a lot of fun.
Yes, exactly. And don't forget, if you guys want to help support the show and you want to help contribute
questions to the show or some of the stuff that we talk about, or help us do more episodes, go to soccercooligans.com/gullysquad. So given that we are here, the All-Star Game is today when you're listening to this, right? So Atletico Madrid against the MLS All-Stars. We did go to the press conference and we got to ask some questions.
That's right.
And that was like a cool experience. I mean, Diego Simeone was there, Coque.
And Savage.
Stefan Savage, right?
Yeah.
Who, obviously, Croatian, I assume, right?
I'm assuming Croatian, something from the Eastern Bloc. Wonderful Spanish.
Wonderful Spanish. Very impressive. Reminded me of Veljko Panovic also.
Yeah.
Who played in Spain. These Croatian, I don't know how these Croatian dudes pick up Spanish so well.
Yeah, if you're a Latino, do not talk spicy in Spanish. You're a Croatian, my guy. They are prepared.
They got it. So, and then the MLS All-Stars, the head coach.
James O'Connor. Joseph Martinez and Matt Hedges.
Walker Zimmerman.
Walker Zimmerman, that's right.
Sure.
I was so close. Walker Zimmerman of LAFC.
They were teammates once.
Yeah, they were. We got to ask a couple funny questions.
Yeah, it was fun.
Christian stopped me from asking a question that probably would have gotten us booted from the conference. But it was a lot of fun. And we asked Joseph Martinez how it felt to have to play in a purple shirt. And he kind of giggled a little bit. He was like, yeah, no, why? You know, and then he gave us the regular media trained answer that it doesn't matter the shirt. You know, I come to play to win. And then I can't wait to go back to Atlanta United and put on my regular shirt, which was kind of cool. You asked about Diego Costa,
Walker Zimmerman having to defend against Diego Costa, who we saw. We went to the Real Madrid Atletico Madrid match.
That's right.
At MetLife, which was wild. A game that started off with 6 goals
in the first half
for Atletico. It was unbelievable. There were so many sad Real Madrid fans.
It was kind of nice to watch. I'm not a fan of either team. You know, I've been a fan of Atletico Madrid in certain times just because of Diego Forlan.
Sure.
Because I only watch teams who have players that I've scared. But it was... It was kind of nice to see, you know, sort of the tables turn a little bit, even if it wasn't a regular season game. The fans treated it like it was the most important game of the season. You know, there were fans arguing back and forth, and there was a lot of passion, a lot of emotion in the game, in the stands. It was very well attended. You know, shouts to ICC once again for hooking us up. Shouts to McDonald's Corporation for getting us a car to and from the game.
Sure. Yeah. That's fun.
That was dope. Yeah. I mean, I like to tell the fans when that happens.
Yeah. I mean, it was pretty crazy. They got us a black, an SUV.
Yeah.
To pick us up and take us to the... It was just wildly unnecessary. Yeah. Thank you so much.
It was perfectly necessary. And once again, we will happily unbox your car service if you want to send us that.
We just unbox the car itself.
Yeah. Oh, do I get to keep this? Who's this dude in the front seat? It was... it was so dope. It was working with ICC has been an absolute blast, and getting a chance that we met Swiss Beats.
Yeah,
we almost met Carmelo Anthony, Bebe. I mean, the names go on and on and on.
It's just a star-studded cast, and us, we were there,
and people were coming up to us and giving us a lot of compliments on Charlotte. Charlotte was a blast. You guys heard all about it. So yeah, hopefully we could do some more stuff with them next year, and you know, keep getting this gully nation out there. Keep getting the name of the Cooligans in a bit brighter spirits.
We gotta rebrand to the Gully CC.
Yeah,
okay,
that's right.
So that was a cool experience, and it's interesting to have seen Atletico Madrid. I'm curious how they're gonna play against the MLS All Stars because clearly. They
came ready to go. João Felix is a beast.
Yeah, dude. I was a little concerned about like Griezmann leaving and what the team was going to look like, but he's a valid replacement.
Yes, and also they spent that money really well.
Yeah.
Zizou didn't really plan.
Yeah. Real Madrid did look slow, unprepared. I think, you lose Real Madrid, you lose that game 2-0. It's like, whatever, it's preseason. You lose 7-3.
Something's wrong.
Something's wrong.
Yeah.
And then and there were reports that Eden Hazard was saying that he came in into the season overweight.
Yeah, what he reports, you could see it.
Yeah, his shoulders looking thick.
Yeah, his belly looking. You could see his belly button.
No, he didn't look like... crazy, overweight or anything like that. But
he had a Mkhitaryan-like offseason,
But it's so weird because the offseason is just like, A couple weeks.
Buddy, you know I could put in work in a couple weeks. Are you kidding me?
What's he doing in just in that short amount of time?
Not going to the gym. That's what he's doing.
He needs to keep twerking. That's what he needs to do.
Yeah, dude. He celebrated too hard. He twerked too hard.
I'm interested to see how they're going to approach the game, given that... If the MLS All-Stars were playing Real Madrid, I'm like, yo, they got this. They're probably going to beat them like 4.
I was going to say at least 4-5 nothing, right?
But Atletico looks ready to go. And it was the first time I got to see Diego Costa play in person. That man is unbelievable. He's one of the toughest, strongest players I've ever seen play in person.
And I'll say this, dark arts need to be renamed to the Diego Costa arts, because that man does everything perfectly if you're trying to disrupt the other team.
Yeah. Yeah.
Using bad tactics.
Well, not only that, but what I was paying attention, I was watching his actual play, right?
Okay, I wasn't. I was like, ooh, he pinched him.
His back to goal, I don't know who's going to get the ball away from him. Nobody. How many people tried to physically push him off the ball?
It doesn't happen.
It just, no matter what size that person was, they could not. And to be able to maintain control when people are physically trying to push you away from the ball and still get around defenders. He's not super fast, but he physically moves you away from him.
Yeah, he'll take you with him if he wants. Yeah he's a mountain of a human being. Also, what I learned from watching him in that game is there's no angle you could force him to where he's not dangerous shooting at the goal. You could have him driving away from goal, and he'll turn and shoot and hit at an angle where the keeper can't stop it. It is legitimately one of the most impressive things I've seen in a long time from someone of that size in soccer. Yeah. Typically, you see someone of that size as more of a defensive midfielder, center back kind of a size. Sure. And he uses it to such incredible effect in the final third. It's wild.
Well, that's why I'm worried the MLS All-Stars are going to get eaten alive.
Are you talking about? Yeah, well, Matt Hedges is going to crush. No, I'm sorry. Walker Zimmerman is going to be just fine.
Okay.
Just draw. You could get him going in a red card. That's all it is.
I'm excited to see MLS defenders up against this guy. It's going to be a challenge for them, and I just want to see what they do. Even if they get embarrassed, I'm like, all right, good for you. You learned something today.
Yeah, if you could train against Zlatan, you'll be all right against Diego. I mean, Diego Costa.
I kind of disagree. Zlatan is not as physical pushing people off
but
the ball.
But, I mean,
ball.
He can be. He's very difficult to get off the ball.
Yes, but not as much. Diego Costa is in a league of his own.
Also, Diego Costa does that thing where he grabs around your neck and he rakes the side of your face with his nails. Every time there's a little bit of scuffle.
I don't want to know why he does in his love life. Yeah. That's not my business.
He's a passionate man. Those are the marks of love.
So, if you're listening to this during the day, the MLS All-Star Game is today. This evening, I believe at 8 p.m. on FS1 and Unimas. So make sure you check it out.
Yeah, give it a check out. I don't know what I just said there. Give it a check out.
We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be back with our next segment. Hopefully my voice is better than it currently is.
It probably will not.
But this is what it is, everybody.
Buddy, let's just blow your voice out completely. Let's go nuts.
I don't even know what that means.
Oh, we're about to find out right after this. Everybody, thanks so much for listening to the podcast. We just want to break in with a word for one of our sponsors, NYC Footy.
NYC Footy, you know, I it's been sad because we've been traveling so much and I haven't been able to play in some of our games, but Cooligans FC has been winning. So I don't know what
is
that means.
Is there a correlation there? I don't know.
I don't think so. It's just a crazy coincidence. But no, NYC Footy, some of the best leagues across New York City. You want to play in Brooklyn.
Beautiful fields, too. Overlooking Lower Manhattan on a pier.
Yeah.
If you want to do that, you can get a little bit of a discount if you use the word Cooligans. Now, you could be an individual player, or you could be a team. I didn't know that.
Exactly. Alex, I'm surprised you didn't know that, because I tell you all the time.
We've done these ads before. So if you are an individual player and you don't have a team, sign up as a free agent. Use Cooligans. You'll get some money back. And if you are a team, you'll get even more money back if you sign up and use the word Cooligans. Again, that's NYC Footy. Check them out. Absolutely amazing. Use Cooligans. You'll love us. Yeah, baby, we're back.
Oh, we are. And now we're in the dungeons
of
ESPN, of wild, wide world of sports.
This is where they keep the Mickey Mouse heads from Disneyland.
Hopefully it's just the masks and not the actual heads in them.
Of course. Yeah, no, not the heads in them. But guys, I mean, look, we talk about we're going to interview amazing guests. And that's just what we do when we come to MLS events, and doesn't get any better than this next guest of ours. You know him. You love him. He's been on our show before. One of my favorite guests. Put your hands together for the one, the only, John Strong.
It's going to be a tennis event here where I'm just sort of doing this the whole
time. Yeah, it's going to be a lot of that. It's going to be a lot of that.
You're going to have a muscular neck issue at some point because it's going to be a lot.
I work with Stu Holden. I've had a muscular neck issue for 2.5 years. Don't worry about it.
Because he breaks necks. You look at him and he's handsome.
Not as many as a pain in my neck, but yes.
That's exactly how I read that.
Okay, well, you know, you went
to his beauty
first. I'm batting 500 now, so we'll keep it up.
John, thank you so much for joining us. And yeah, it is pretty wild to be. I've never, the last time I was in Orlando was, I came here and I went to SeaWorld and Universal Studios with my first girlfriend.
Wow.
It was my first like vacation. Like, I felt like an adult.
What was the weather like last spring when you were doing that?
Oh, sure. Yes. I just celebrated my 21st birthday. Yeah. That's pretty exciting.
I will tell you this. Christian's girlfriend is on this trip for a few days. And while I was with them, the news broke that the last time he was here, he brought an ex-girlfriend. And I
was going to ask which one of the conversation.
It did not break.
That news broke.
Did she want to hear that news again? No, she did not.
No. But she didn't want to be reminded. This is what Jane came to the kids.
When you have another significant other, yes, the previous ones don't exist anymore. You bury those stories.
Photoshop them out of your prom photos. Yes.
Very true.
Yes. I never learned. That's my problem.
My wife is still mad at my mother for having my prom photo up. I'm like, it's my prom photo. That's allowed. It's not a picture of us at Chuck E. Cheese.
it's been great, guys. I really appreciate the time.
This is why you bring John on, just to have a relationship. Advice with John Strong.
John, apologies for my voice. It's been a rough go out here in Orlando.
It's very husky. It's got a nice timbre to it.
It's a little whiskey-ish.
It is, yeah. Okay. Listen, I went on the air with laryngitis earlier this year, so I can't really say anything.
Oh, impressive.
That was not a fun day.
Okay.
Week two of the season, so I'm not going to make any comments.
Did your stoic, iconic voice change at all?
Yeah, it sounded like I was gargling gravel the whole time. It was awful. It was bad. And I hated every minute of it, and it freaked me out, and it was the worst thing. Because it's, you know, I compare it to, and I had to be careful how I said this in front of Stu, but it's sort of like if you're a player and, you know, you tear an ACL.
Right.
That's your livelihood there. And that was the thing with me. It was like this horrible week of just, you know, and I thought I was going to get better, and I didn't. We did the game, and it was the worst thing ever. And then I had a tube snake down my throat the next day back at home, and it was the whole thing. So that was more than you guys were interested in. But the point
not
being,
at all. Actually, I was so interested because you know, you go through that moment as comedians. I lost my voice when I started when we started doing the podcast a lot, and I thought, oh my
also
god!
Also, when you starred in The Little Mermaid,
I found it again by the end of the movie, which is kind of cool. Turns out I've been using a fork all wrong. So I freaked out because I thought this is my life. Yeah. What do I do? It's a lot like tearing an ACL. You think, is it ever going to change? And to the fans, they prayed and they lit candles. They did not. Nobody cared. But John, actually, I have a great question for you. As someone who calls these games, and this is your life, how much vitamin C do you take in on a daily basis?
I do every morning. I get it's emergency, but it's like the special, like immunity, like it's a higher level. I get it at Costco. I get it in bulk.
Okay.
And every single morning, that's
you go wholesale.
The first thing I do is that with water to sort of start hydration, but get that in. And listen, I got two young kids, so and I'm on airplanes, and you have all these things around you, and it's at, you know, my wife and I joke that this is the money maker, so we sort of make jokes about that. But the honest truth is that I have no other discernible skill set. I have no other way to provide for my family. So if I'm not able to talk and talk well or speak good, the whole thing sort of breaks down. So yeah, I've introduced Stu to the special tea that I drink. I've got Ricola cough drops. I've got all these things that I do to make sure that.
You're gonna have to share this with us off camera.
Oh, there's a whole
I'm
thing.
Have to get this routine. Yeah.
My wife just told me I should start using eye cream. You know, because I'm gonna be on TV.
For your voice,
she says.
I don't know how it's gonna help.
Well, let me tell you, it's disgusting tasting. No, so I put it on my eyes, and
I think your wife is trying to poison you, man.
She told me this new cyanide treatment for your throat. I was like, if I'm taking care of my eyes, I should probably take care of my voice, right? And even though I'm known for having a bit of a hoarse like voice, you know, whatever hoarse voice or rough voice, I need to take care of it, right? I can't completely lose it. So I was interested in that. Well, how do you prepare for an MLS All-Star game? Because the players take it serious, but it seems like no one else does. Everyone else is like, well, this is a fun thing. But then you guys show up and you're calling it like it's a World Cup final.
I wouldn't go that far, but I think
World Cup semifinal?
Yeah, sure. There, yeah. I would say World Cup group stage, Denmark, France, where neither team wanted to be there. No. Okay. It's a different prep because you understand what it is and what it isn't. And this is my third All-Star game, and I've done ICC games over the years. I've done the friendlies where it's European Club X against MLS Team Y. And you understand that you're not calling it quite the same way. And it's more about, can I provide – because you think about it from the perspective of a fan. You know, oh, my guys at the All-Star game. So you want to have something nice to say about each player when they come on, a little nugget for the fans who don't know the other players, yep. A little bit of background on, you know, who Atletico are and some of their players. And so it's much more, it's much less, I'm not looking up formations or, you know, recent records or some of those things. It's more, can I get a good 10-second nugget on each player that's going to see the field? And then the rest of the time, you know, call the game to a certain extent, you know, try to involve Katie more. We're trying to do some innovative things. We'll see if they all pan out because there's pushback from different people. Can we get more sort of from the players on the field, things like that, and try to push the envelope? Because, yeah, I think if you do it like a regular game, people sort of know it isn't.
Sure.
So right. You have to try to find other things to make it interesting and fun. And what I'm hoping for this game, now, again, people are theoretically listening to this after the game has happened. So judge me if I'm right or not.
They'll be listening to this before the game.
But my hope, yes. Perfect. Okay, good. So, and then just burn it afterwards. And then the hope is that with, you know, you got Zlatan, you got Vela, you got Rooney, you got Nani, you got Pozuelo, you got et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Right. The tricks and the flicks and the skill and the quality. And then also a team in Atletico who, and we spoke to a couple of their players today. I don't think Diego Simeone does preseason half-assed friendlies.
Not at all. We were there at the Real Madrid, like Madrid game in New York.
Yes, you saw the way they play. We saw the training session today. There's a Christmas to it. There's an intensity to it. Yeah. And so in that regard, yeah, they're not going at it all the way, but they're going to go for it more than, honestly, Real Madrid 2 years ago. Dish did not want to be there, and right. That brought the game down. Sure. And so that's my hope, actually. It's a good opponent to have in that regard. It might make for a good game.
You know what? I'll disagree there. I think Atletico is not a good opponent when it comes to the flash and skills and tricks. They're one of the most defensive teams in the world.
In that regard, I
would have agreed with you until the 6-0 in the first half against yes, Real Madrid. Sure. Yeah, seems to be a little bit of flash there.
No, well, the defensive in that, I don't think the MLS All-Stars will score a goal. And I'm worried that they're going to be so embarrassed. This is the first time I'm like that concerned, that they're just going to put like a defensive masterclass, and the MLS All-Stars, given as great as they are, that their individual ability will not overcome that defensive chemistry that they have.
But it's also like a meaningless, in the sense that if that happens, it doesn't matter. It's more about the fanfare and the what is it, the pageantry of it. In a game like this, how much in a regular game, how much personal stories percentage wise of the calling the game can you add? Just like, because, you know, I grew up listening to John Sterling, you know, John Sterling on the radio. And he's one of those guys who'd be like, I had the chicken parm. It was great. Derek Jeter 2-2. Anyway, so there's a guy with a violin. Like, the game didn't matter to him. You know what I mean? Like, it was, I would say, like 80%.
Because you're doing 162 of them and you're bored. Yeah, and you're trying to entertain yourself. And I'll be
and
honest.
It's baseball.
One of my heavy influences and the reason why I do a lot of that storytelling, a guy by the name of Rich Burke, who is a longtime minor league baseball broadcaster in Portland, and he is a Vin Scully acolyte. He is of the school of Scully. And so I learned through that idea of weaving the storytelling in, because I find it interesting. And so to your question, in a regular game, I'll try to find two or three. Because a couple things. I think it's interesting personally. Number two, I think it's worthwhile to get you to know who these players are, because sometimes you don't. It's not like a LeBron James where he's covered, you know, 24 hours a day, all these sports talk shows. Yeah. If it's MLS guys, where else are you hearing about them potentially? And I think it also has been a way for me to differentiate myself from other play-by-play announcers. So in this game, theoretically, a little bit more, trying to get a little bit tighter, with the understanding that in a regular game and sometimes in this, I sometimes go too far. I sometimes am on a super long story. I'm doing too many. And at a certain point, whether it's my producer or my wife is texting me or my own voice in my head is like, why don't you just back off and just let's just take a few plays off and not talk for a minute. So trying to find that right balance. But I think it is relevant to a game like this to again, particularly, you know, one of the ones I've had in my head is Nick Raimondo. And sort of, if I can do it, eulogy is the wrong word, but
R.I.P. Nick Raimondo, by the way, guys.
but some sort of a little honorific to Nick Raimondo, sure. You know, his last All-Star game, his last season. I'm going to have 15 seconds at some point to say something about him. What do I want to say to sort of, you know, give a little nod to Nick Romano? So, well, things like that.
I mean, one thing I would suggest, because we had discussed this before you called the MLS Cup final last year, we had suggested, hey, you know what? Wouldn't it be nice if you threw the word gully in the broadcast? Oh, look, you weren't able to.
We tried to work. Can we say naughty words on this? I mean, this is I try not to. We tried to work in shithousery.
which is such a great word. It sounds like only grandpas use it, so it's okay.
We fell in love with that word at the World Cup last year, Stu and I. And we had been trying to find a way during the Gold Cup. And so finally during the final, I think I said something about, there's a word for that. And Stu goes, housery, I think is the word. I think shenanigans is sort of a... So sometimes you try to get things like getting fired.
Diego Costa is going to be at this game, so I have a feeling you're going to be able to use that word.
Well, yeah. But if ever a player and a manager have been kindred spirits, Diego Costa and Diego Simeone, I think would be two.
They're basically a UFC tag team that decided to play soccer.
Reason 18 why I actually am sort of excited about this game, just the specific dynamics of it.
I just think because it's an All-Star game, because it's quote unquote meaningless.
You want me to say goalie?
I just think
right. I have the shirt, by the way. You guys gave me the shirt.
Yes. That's right.
I kept the shirt. I work out in it. I still have it around.
Okay. All
right. I get sideways glances at my gym in like suburban Portland, Oregon, where they're like, I'm pretty sure that's inappropriate. Yeah. But I don't know for sure. So
all I think is, because it's an All-Star game, there's much less risk of anybody slapping your wrist.
Potentially. Counterpoint to that, this is the one game a year that the Fox Sports executives will probably be watching. So I have better luck in a couple of weeks when it's like LA Galaxy versus Seattle Sounders later that weekend. I'm actually more in the clear there. But I get your point.
You did mention us in Minnesota for the stadium opening when you were on Alexi Lawless's podcast.
That's right, yes.
So thank you for that. That was really kind of you.
The live soccer podcasting capital of the Upper Midwest. For a three-week stretch there,
Did you get
the Juicy Lucy, by the way?
Did we do that as well.
Yeah, that was good stuff.
I get it. You make a burger that the inside of it will burn your entire face. Thank you so much. Let's talk a little bit about calling the game different today in 2019 as it has been in the past. I was talking to Kevin Egan, right? Great guy. Calls the Atlanta United games. And I said something to the referee. I referenced that when U.S. Didn't qualify for the World Cup, he was on air and he wanted to say something stoic, Walter Cronkite-ish.
Because what was his role? He was in the studio that day, right?
He was at BN.
He was in the studio that day.
And he aired on Jones in that game.
And I was having lunch with the two of them, and they had mentioned they started referencing this game was the last time they worked together.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, what makes the air now, or what gets memes and gets the views, is going wild, doing essentially what we do, because we're not quote unquote professionals or professional in any way, shape, or form.
I don't think you need the air quotes there. You can say you're not professional, but that's fine.
But almost like on purpose. What you do is you want to think of sort of that stoic right thing to say that's somewhat poetic. And that, to some degree, maybe I'm wrong, feels like that's starting to become passé, and TV execs want you to get the buzz. Like, what's the buzz thing to say? What's the hot topic?
There's a couple answers to that, because the Walter Cronkite is a good starting point, because it's something I've thought of. You know, Bob Lee is one of my sort of idols. He's on my Mount Rushmore of influences, because he mixes sports announcing with news anchoring. And in fact, a lot of my early broadcast experience was as a news anchor. So that idea of, and there was a great piece on The Ringer a couple years ago of basically what Walter Cronkite and his ilk used to be. Now news anchors have no respect, but it's sort of the lead network sports announcer, the Joe Buck, the Al Michaels, the Jim Nance are sort of seen in that sort of realm. So there is an awareness of that. The idea, as you're saying, the sort of willingness to step out a little bit and get a little bit of buzz. It's funny, because one of the old axioms in broadcasting was, and this is something I was taught growing up, the idea, the phraseology is it's off to Pluto. The idea is you say something. If you make a mistake, just forget about it, because it's off to Pluto. It's a radio wave and no one's ever going to remember, and just get on with it. Well, that was true 10 years ago. It's not true now.
Right.
Everything is saved. Everything is online. It's awful announcing. It's deadspin. It's everything else. And so there is, you know, and there's an irony sometimes with writers who get drafts and copy editors and all these different revisions they can do, crushing us who work in a live environment, who get one shot to say any given
thing.
You're
essentially improvising for 90 minutes.
Yes, 100%. And so What I have done is tried to resist the temptation. I do feel there are diminishing returns if you're trying too hard to be too outlandish or be too memorable.
That's like the SportsCenter effect.
Yes, or specifically, the boom goes the dynamite kid, or the old. Yeah. There was an old SNL sketch with like Ray Romano where he's trying to sort of be the wacky SportsCenter anchor. Yeah. And it is dangerous because I hear a lot of kids coming up that do that, and there are announcers that do that, and they have a little bit of success. I'm not interested in going viral. I'm interested in having a 30-year long career. And so I think you have to resist that temptation. And where I've found success is by not necessarily doing that. Because listen, there are, one of the things I think that American announcers, i.e. me, tends to lose in comparison to English announcers is that the poetry, the little rhetorical flourish, the little one line that gets in. A lot of those guys, that's all pre-prepared. It's stuff written down on cards in front of them. And that's another thing that I was hammered at me as a broadcaster is don't script out.
Right.
Let it be spontaneous. But there are also times that a goal happens. I'm not entirely sure what to say. Like my brain's trying to catch up to what I've just seen. Sure. So, it's something I wrestle with a lot. And I take very seriously these elements of what I do is the balance between not wanting to be overly scripted, not wanting to try too hard because there's a danger to that.
Sure.
But also if you're just sort of bland and unmemorable, that was something one of my bosses once told me, is you have to put your stamp on that moment. You have to tell me this is a John Strong goal.
Right.
Otherwise, we'll just have someone else. Like, why are you there and not someone else? And so trying to find that is a difficult thing to do. You know, and I will say some of the moments that I felt got away from me have been – or the ones where I felt most sort of hanging my head out the window of a moving car have been the ones that people have responded to the most, So like when Zlatan scored the goal last year and I just went, come on, or the one where I completely lost my mind when Bradley scored at the Azteca or things like that, that in the moment I'm like, eesh, tends to have, but I think because I don't do that often, I think I did it every game.
Yes, exactly right.
And so, saving it for, that was another thing, if you consider this is zero and me screaming my head off as a 10, something I learned as a baseball broadcaster, if you go to 9 on a 2-out double in the 4th inning in April, what are you going to have when you've just won the title?
Exactly.
And being able to sort of reserve it enough so that when the big moment comes, you've got a level you can go to you don't do all the time.
Right.
Yeah, you know what? That now that you even just say that, all these big moments that you've called, they're never the same moment.
That's the idea.
Yeah, it's an organic.
Because everyone is different. And that's been my, and it's dangerous and difficult to minefield in some of these things. But that would be my argument against, is maybe not the way I want to say it. But the contrast to Spanish language announcing, culturally different.
Yeah.
But the idea being that if your call is the same for every single goal, theoretically, every goal is different. Every goal means something different. The context is different. And so that's, again, that's what I've been taught growing up.
Sure. It's just a different style, right? Yeah. And speaking to that.
You're having a hard time over there. Can I get you something? Can we get you a lozenge? Can we?
I have them in there, in my bag.
It sounds like you swallowed a coat. Never
mind. There's Captain Morgan's one floor up. They're now an official league partner. I can smuggle a bottle out for you.
That'll clear me right up.
Buddy, that'll make it feel a lot better.
But speaking of that, because some calls could sometimes feel like almost a brand, right? Like a branding thing.
Yeah.
And the one that comes to mind, and I don't know who does this call, a Spanish language call. He's the guy that whenever a great goal happens, he just says the word golazo and then screams the word golazo. I don't know who that is.
It is, and I'm it's Univision's announcer, and he's their lead. Why am I spacing on his name right now? No. It's their lead guy. I can picture him in my mind, but he'll do that.
Yeah.
Where it'll be, blah, 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 goal. Goal. And that's sort of the way. And it's his way, because you have to get a full breath of air. And if you've been calling the action, you haven't done that. And so that's his way of marking it. It's in. I see it's in. Buy myself a half second, get my full lung of air.
The reason I love it is because it sounds like he is in absolute shock that happened.
Yes.
And we're experiencing that.
I'm looking
with
up his name because I don't want to be the idiot that didn't know. Keep talking, though. I'm listening.
But it is like, he's like, he says golazo. And then I'm like, he's like, is he okay? Is he going to be all right?
He builds tension, though.
Yeah.
And there's something exciting about that. And you don't think about how much calling of the game is important until you watch a, like a highlight and they don't have the announcer in it.
Oh,
and
sure.
You're like, why am I hearing boom, boom, boom all day? I want to hear like the, just the ball getting kicked. You want to hear the excitement. And you become the voice inside my head when I watch.
There's a pill for that, by the way.
Well, I don't take it. Put it in a chicken parm and I'll consider it. But when I watch an MLS game live, I'm like, man, I wish John Strong was sitting next to me.
You know, that was actually one of the first. Pablo Ramirez, thank you. That was
Pablo Ramirez.
That was one of the first really fun compliments I got. Calling women's lacrosse at the University of Oregon, one of my early gigs on the campus radio station, and the parents of the coach, Jen Larson, her parents came to a game, and they said afterwards to her, "We didn't like watching the game in person as much because we couldn't hear John." And I was like, "You know what? That's probably the best possible way."
That's great.
If I'm adding to your enjoyment, if I'm adding to whatever it is, if I'm giving you something out of the game better than you would have had sitting in the stands, but I'm not taking away from it by over talking, I feel like that's actually the perfect, that's what I'm trying to do, to make your enjoyment of the game better, make you understand a little bit better what you're seeing or enjoy it more, have more context, whatever, without necessarily overshadowing the game.
Right.
You know?
Do you think the era of the guys, like what Will Ferrell used to do, the guy from Chicago,
Harry Carey,
like these maniacs.
Yes.
What was it? Phil Rizzuto, when I was a young kid, he would take he would leave in the seventh inning because he wanted to beat the traffic from the actual game he was calling. And in the ninth inning, they would show the GWB, and the guy was still there. It's like, there's Scooter on the GWB crossing the bridge. Like, those types of guys are iconic because they were like Dean Martin. They did whatever they wanted.
And a lot
wanted.
Of them were buzzed on the air.
Oh, 100%.
They were drinking during the game.
Which is why I made the Dean Martin reference.
Yes.
They were trashed.
I have once had alcohol while on the air, but I'm not going to – I've referenced the game earlier, but you weren't. You might not be able to connect the two, but continue.
All right, good.
I've done that once.
What?
Denmark, France? Is
that
what it was?
That would have been the one.
But you should have had one. You needed it. Like, do you think about what your legacy will be? Like, if someone makes an impression of you, do you think about, like, you know what? Maybe I should start drinking.
Stu is a good impression of me, by the way. Okay. It's an interesting because I think that's something I've read, particularly in baseball, that the era of the guy that has the local gig for 30 years and he's way different and he's weird, but you know, that era is over. And it's more sort of replaceable, interchangeable professional announcers that don't necessarily have a distinctive brand or distinctive personality.
Right.
Which runs counter to the other just as accurate concept you talked about earlier, is
right.
The announcer who's sort of being a little bit crazy and is trying to go viral. Like, both of those things are true. It's an interesting concept because it is something I think about, that what do I want to be defined by? If I can do this, it was something I got in my head a lot about after the World Cup. I'm 33 years old. I've done a World Cup. Like, what? And the image, and I might have made this comparison to you guys last year when I saw you last. You know, I think of what's the difference between the Macarena and Brown Eyed Girl? That one becomes this massive sensation, but sort of blows itself out.
And the other. And is also the greatest song ever made.
And the other. I'm assuming you're talking about Brown Eyed Girl. But how do you create something that actually lasts and create a career that lasts, and trying to do that without trying too hard to do it, if that
right.
makes sense? You know?
I think to help sustain your career, you need to start doing makeup tutorials on YouTube.
Right. Okay. I've seen that guy. And that's the thing. I do all my own makeup. That was one of our – at the Confederations Cup was the Chileans laughing at us in the bathroom in Kazan, because Stu and I are doing our makeup in this mirror and all that, and they're sort of looking at us like, what is wrong with these Americans?
Yeah. They're just drinking mate, smoking cigars.
Yeah, they're having a grand old time. No, but I think about that of, you know, what is it – what would be that sort of thing? And I think trying to find, yeah, like you said, sort of that mix of being memorable without necessarily doing things that overshadow the game.
Yeah.
Because at the end of the day, I have two kids to put through college. I have to keep this job for like 20 years, I think.
Okay.
Until Stella's old enough to get through college. So
jeez,
I basically,
you want to keep working until you're 55? 20
yeah, exactly.
More years? Jesus, buddy.
So that's my biggest goal here. If yeah. I can just stay employed that long enough, then the rest will take care of
all
itself.
Right. I think you're going to make it happen.
I think you'll be just fine.
I'm hopeful.
I always, just to wrap up, I always love talking to you about the Portland Timbers. You are our Timbers expert.
Right.
Brian Fernandez.
Yes.
Speaking
of crazy people.
Yes. Brian. We called him like a bruiser on this show because there's almost like – he's not a poacher. He's a bruiser.
You know what he is? He's actually remarkably similar to how my wife was as a player. She would become this different person in the field. She would become a lunatic.
Okay.
And she would run around the field like a crazy person. But she made her team better. She scored goals. She unsettled the opposing team. Brian Fernandez is a very interesting one because we had a lot of conversations with Gio Savarese. And you, a great example of it is they bring him off in the game against the Galaxy, and he's losing his mind. He's screaming at the coaches. He's kicking the benches. He gets back up off the bench and is doing this and MFing the coaches and all this. And Gio at one point turns around and is like, just sit down. And so one of the coaches comes over and spends a minute with him. Zarek Valentin comes over for a minute. Diego Valeri, like they take turns. And that's sort of what this is. This is going to be a process of managing a 24-year-old kid who in the truest sense, he comes from a life on the street. Mm-hmm. He has very little formal education. He has had a very tough life. He's had problems with drugs. He's had problems getting himself, finding trouble.
Yeah.
That he's now, you know, in Portland, Oregon, trying to make it work in MLS now. And how can the Timbers manage that, get the best things that are out of him, try to smooth or at least deal with the rough edges? Because if they get that right, I think Portland's got a real chance to be a legit contender this year.
Yeah.
They've got all the other pieces, and what they needed was that little bit of craziness on the other end of the field.
They needed a Gio Savarese on the field, and they got
that. That helps. Yeah. You know, or you think about how, you know, the idea of the Galaxy is 10 guys be good enough so that Zlatan can win the game for you. But, sure. But I think Portland's got a better structure than the Galaxy do in that regard. But they need that extra little piece. And so that the whole season rests on that. If they can just keep him almost like a nuclear missile,
yeah.
If they can just keep him pointing in the right direction, they're going to have success. If he flies off sideways, which is very possible, the whole thing implodes. So I think it's one of the most fascinating storylines in MLS the rest of the year.
It's impressive to watch what he's been able to do.
Yeah.
Amazing. And he won the fans over 5 minutes in.
Yeah.
That LAFC game in June, I was up in the stands. 5 minutes in, everyone saw how hard this guy is working. He's relentless. He's everywhere. And he has quality. That's the type of athlete that people in Portland love. Is if you do all the other pieces and you're good enough to do something at the end. So he'll be a fan favorite quick if he can... Again, just sort of keep someone on the straight of narrow.
Exactly. He looks like he's fitting in quite nicely to the clearly, like it seems like there's another Argentinian national team that the Portland Timbers are becoming.
Right? I was having a conversation with Nat Borchers that the days when he was on the team, it's like Nat Borchers and Jack Jewsbury and Ned Gabavoy and Will Johnson and all these things. And now it's all Spanish being spoken. Yeah. Gio's coaching in Spanish. The players are coaching Spanish. It's been a sea change in MLS, but the Timbers have been in front of it. Colombian players, Argentinian players, Central and South Americans. It's changed this league.
Yes, it has.
I would argue very much for the better. But we have seen a sea change in this league with the types of players being brought in. And Portland is as good an example as any.
A sea change spelled S-I change.
well played. Well done. On that note, good night, everyone.
John Strong, thank you so much for joining us. You're going to be calling the game. The All-Star Game with Stu Holden on Fox
and
Sports.
And Katie with him.
Katie with him.
Katie is the star of our show.
Katie's back because she was away raising her new baby for a little bit.
In air quotes, yes.
She was,
We raise Owen as much as she does. But yes.
the Fox Sports fund to Danny. Yeah,
exactly. So it is great to see her back. So that's been awesome. So, John, thank you so much for joining us on the show. It's always an absolute honor. Should we wrap up?
Yes, let's do what we normally do. Okay. Scream it again, baby. You can save
and meanwhile, the poor people in the office that are sharing a false wall over here. Please finish. Please, God,
well,
finish.
Well, we got an applause. All right. So they had to listen to a part of a Cooligans podcast. So
for John Strong, my name is Christian Polanco.
And please don't scream because your voice. My name is Alex Guerrero. So together, what are we?
The Cooligans!